Hey guys, welcome to Rockin' the Country. I'm Don, and first I want to thank all of you who are leaving really kind and thoughtful and sometimes humbling comments. And I mean, I don't know if I overanalyze things, but I like to make connections in life about how things work. And you know, the folks who are into the lyrics of country music, traditional, who have the patience, who have the sense to listen and dive into the lyrics, the stories that traditional country is known for, I just think there's something special about that. I don't want to say better. I mean, I have my thoughts on things, but you're attracted to lyrics, you're attracted to stories, you're attracted to the human drama, all of that, and so am I. And so when I see the comments that resonate within me, some of which are very kind, it's humbling, and it's also encouraging, and all that. So I wanted to acknowledge you guys who are doing that. And for those of you who have left requests, recommendations for songs, I'm trying to get to them, but you know, I post one a day because I do have other things I'm doing in life, but I make sure to stay true to that one a day. And I'm going to do a video. I've had 10 or 12 blocked after I did all the work on them. A couple of them I was just sort of like crestfallen, if you will, that they didn't get published because, you know, when I'm doing these videos, it's not scripted. And so even after I've reacted to a song, I don't necessarily remember what it is that I said even immediately after it. And so it's when I go to the editing process that I see what I've said. And some of them I'm like, oh my God, I went in deep on that one. And the song itself is heart-wrenching or joyful or whatever it may be. And there's like a symbiosis between me who's reacting to it, or if you were reacting to one, you know, it would be the same thing, a symbiosis between you and the song, and then it gets blocked and you're like, ah. But I'll do a video on the 10 or 12 that got blocked, just talking about them briefly to let you know which ones. But I'm trying to get to the requests, obviously. But there's only 365 days in a year. So all that said, I am doing a reaction today, though, of Keith Whitley. And Keith Whitley, everybody pretty much in the music, country music business respects Keith Whitley's music. I'm reacting to his song, I'm Over You. And here's the dealio on Keith. He passed away in 1989 at age 33. So we just have his music left, really, in the memory of who he was. And this song was off of his 1989 album, I Wonder, Do You Think of Me? That's the name of the album. So I don't know if he ever got to see how successful this album was and the public's response to it, because he died the year it was released. So it's just one of those things. And this was recommended by subscriber KCC. So it's like capital K, lowercase C, space, capital C. I don't know what that refers to, KCC, but that's what I'm going to call you, or KC squared or something like that. But let's just get into it. I don't know the song. And so we're going to do a true reaction, turning my hat backwards, which I haven't done in a while. I've been leaving them forward. Why that's important to me, I don't know. Here we go.
Where there's a cloud don't mean there's rain. Tears in my eyes don't mean there's pain. Don't flatter yourself, I'm over you.
This is country.
Things aren't always what they seem. You can't believe everything you read on my face. I'm over you.
I don't know where he's going with it.
You heard I'm drinking more than I should. That I ain't been looking all that rough and why they make those stories up. When I'm over you.
Yeah, that's what he wants to believe.
There were times if you'd been around, you would have seen me broken down. But now I'm over you.
There's, in psychology, there's this thing called cognitive dissonance, where there's, in a sense, a disconnect between what you see in the world and what you believe about it. And you have to adjust one or the other. You have to adjust your belief about the thing in the world, about the way it works, or you have to alter your perception. Maybe they're one and the same. It's like if you turn on a, you believe that you turn on a light switch and the light comes on every time. And so your belief is lining up with what happens in the world. There's no disconnect, no dissonance. But when you flip the switch that time and the light doesn't come on, it's like, why not? Why didn't it come on? So either you have to change your belief that each time you hit the switch, it goes on, or then you've got to look at the way in which it works. And maybe the belief becomes most of the time that light bulb comes on when I hit the switch because the bulb burned out, the power's out, or you didn't really hit the switch well enough. And so it's only halfway up, not enough to, you know, complete the circuit. That's an okay example. But one of the ways in which psychologists and psychiatrists will address psychological issues, however we define that with people, like in relationships or how they perceive themselves, is to get them to say something that they want to see happen in the world. Maybe, I am successful. I am successful. I am successful. Like if you've been failing at whatever, maybe work or relationships or whatever, and you sort of like kind of cause yourself to believe something. So it's kind of like, I don't know if it's jump starting or short circuiting, you know, a way to alter the way you're approaching yourself in relation to the world and possibly the world in relation to what you believe. So this is how my brain works, obviously. When I hear a song like this where he's like, I'm over you, it's like, that's what he'd like, it might be what he'd like her to believe, but it's probably what he'd like himself to believe so that he could stop feeling the pain of her having been gone. And that's just what we call lying to ourselves. And sometimes there's a self-preservation benefit to lying to ourselves about that. Some folks say lying is always wrong, but I guess it depends on how you define lying. And, you know, which I actually studied that in college too in philosophy. Cicela Bock's book on lying, she said it was an intent to deceive. That was her basic definition, an intent to deceive. And there's more to it, but sometimes we intend to deceive ourselves just so that we can sort of get past something. I'll see if that's where he goes. All right.
So if I seem a little bit cold, it only means you've lost the hold you have on me. I'm over you.
I love this.
You heard I'm drinking more than I should, that I ain't been loving all that good. Someone taking it rough, but why they making those stories up when I'm over you? You heard I'm drinking more than I should, and I hate being looking all that good.
Yeah.
Someone told you I was taking it rough. Why are they making those stories I'm over you.
Yeah. You know, it's one of those songs where he doesn't tell you whether he's lying to himself or not. He leaves it up to the listener to decide, am I lying? And I'll tell you why I think he's lying. Because he said, that you put this part in there just as a hint. I'm drinking more than I should. Like someone told you I'm drinking more than I should. Which means it's out there in public. Like people, small towns, people know what each other's doing anyhow. But drinking too much and it doesn't look all that good. Translation, I'm not over you. I'm not. But, you know, another thought struck me, and I think about the country music and the snap track coming out of Nashville and the sensationalism that takes place in different media, like movies where, you know, go back to Arnold Schwarzenegger and Bruce Willis and the blow them up type of sensationalism. And then once you start down that path, other aspects of movie telling and the stories and the cinematography have to sort of keep pace with that. And it's like if you you paint one wall in your living room, right? And you're like, all right, this wall is a little, or maybe that's not a good example. You change the doorknob because it's, you know, maybe rusty or something. It just isn't rusty. You change the doorknob, you got a shiny new one in there. And then you're like, well, the hinges now, they don't match that. And so you replace the hinges, but then that makes other parts of the living room not look right. And then you're like, okay, now I got to paint this wall. And then after you paint the wall, it's like, well, all of a sudden the carpeting doesn't look right. So you got to replace the carpeting. And it just keeps going. And it's like that in the difference between traditional country and contemporary country, pop country with the snap track and whatever else, is that traditional country didn't go down that path of sensationalizing anything. The vocalists stay in the pocket. They just tell the story and let the story tell itself. They don't try to oversell it with emotion. The drumming doesn't come in too hard. You don't get the long guitar riffs, because once you start with long guitar riffs regularly, then you got to go, got to give the drummer his time. Then the bass player's got to get his time and all that. So then you wind up essentially with either rock or a lot of the pop country, like Florida Georgia Line coming out of Nashville. And I'm not decrying them. They're obviously Florida Georgia Line, they're headliners. They sell out everywhere. People love them, and good for them, because there are some country elements to what they do. And I think over time, as people get older and decades go by in their lives, they're going to want to, they'll see the traditional country like, oh, this, I love this. Nobody's trying to sell me on anything. There's just a story about a sliver of life, and I can listen to it. And I have to listen to it because nothing's being jammed down my ears. Steel guitar isn't being jammed down my ears. No screaming vocalists, none of that. It's just everybody's in the pocket on a song like I'm Over You by Keith Whitley. So, you know, I've reacted to a song or two of his before. And, you know, the fact that this song came out the same year he passed away, I'm going to leave it be. I'm not going to rate the song. But this is a really good song for what the songwriter was going for. I mean, it would be over a 9. I mean, probably be a 9. So take that for what it's worth. Read between the lines. You know, this is one of those songs. It just made me think. And there are times where I'm sure I'm like, oh my God, I'm in so much pain. I just want it to be different. And I'm just going to say it's different. It's different. Or you wake up and you're like, please let this be a dream. Let what just took place having been a dream. I want to wake up. And there are different ways where we try to go into denial. But this song made me think of all of that. I mean, go figure, a simple song, I'm over you. But he's not. So that's it. Keith Whitley, the man. I mean, this dude died too young, as we know. 33. Man. KCC, thank you so much for this recommendation. You've been such a wonderful addition to the channel. That's kind of rude to put it that way, but your comments are so welcome, so thoughtful. You're clearly intelligent, Not to be judgmental, but I mean, that's just, insightful. You're all of that. So thank you so much. And that's it. All right, guys, Keith Whitley's I'm Over You. He's from Ashland, Kentucky, too, by the way. So Kentuckians, enjoy that. He's a credit to Kentucky. Have a great day, guys. See you on another video. Keep rocking the country.